Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome into this Adobe Photoshop tutorial brought to you by Tutvid.com. I'm Nathaniel Dodson. Today, we're going to take a look at the curves adjustment in Photoshop. I've long said that I think that this is the single most important feature in Photoshop. I've done a bunch of videos on it before, and this is just another one of those videos covering curves, maybe from a different angle, maybe from a more interesting perspective. It's just the way I think about curves, and especially if you're into photography, curves may very well be the absolute most important tool, feature, function, you name it, in Photoshop. And I really ought to think you know a little something about it. So if you care to stick around, we're going to jump into Photoshop right now and check this thing out. Yes, so here we are in Photoshop, and all just feels right with the world when we settle in to a nice new image in Photoshop. Let's talk about curves. So my favorite way of working with curves is adding a curves adjustment layer, but just in the interest of being fully transparent, you can also go image adjustments and add a curves adjustment. Oh, there it is right there. That's how infrequently I come up here. Image adjustment curves. And if you apply this to a smart object, it will be a non-destructive addition. The little arrow will appear over here. You can bump down and, you know, edit the curves and all that, this, that, and the other. I'm going to stick with the curves adjustment layer like that. In fact, I'm going to pop this out so we're working with it in the dialogue, because I've got this really bad habit of moving dialogue boxes around and people complain about it, and I want to keep the people happy. So here's the basic of how curves will work. You click anywhere along this line to add a point. See that? And then you can drag these points. If you pull up, you add brightness. If you pull down, you add darkness. It's really that simple. That's the basics of how curves work. You can grab that point, drag it away, and get rid of it. You can add multiple points. Like, we can come down here and say, you know what? Make my darks a little bit darker. And then I'll come up here and say, hey, make my brights a bit brighter. And I can shut my adjustment layer off. And look at that. We infused a bunch of contrast. Because we make the darks darker and the brights brighter, well, you're going to infuse contrast. I've got this little reset arrow down here at the bottom of the dialog box. I hit that. Boom. We're back to normal. Now, all the way down here, this point, this is the black point. You can see everything around it is black. All the way up here, this is the white point, the very brightest stuff in our image. You can see it aligns with the sort of white end of these two gradient stripes. Now, behind this, we see a histogram. I did a video on how to read a histogram. I highly recommend it, because being able to read the histogram in an instance like this can be very, very helpful. Let me give you an example. You can say, you know what, I want to darken my darks down here. But right around the point they get become midtones again, I want to brighten them back up. But then up here in the very brightest parts of the image, I actually want to tone that down, and then I want to dull the whites quite a bit. And you can see if I shut off the curves adjustment layer, there's what we had. If I turn it on, here's what we have. A total shift in the tonal value of the image, and a very funky looking curve if you don't really know what's going on. But because I understand how curves is working, and I understand how to read the histogram, I'm able to go in and have an idea of what I'm doing when I'm pushing and pulling things. All right, I'm going to reset curves again. That was just to give you an example. I don't mean to, like, blow you away with this information or anything. Just know that being able to read the histogram can be very, very valuable. Speaking of white and black points, you can click the black point, you can boost the black point. You can see it gives our image an overall faded look. You can also take the black point, and if you push it toward the center, it's going to just deepen all the blacks and infuse the image with contrast. Same thing with the white point. If you move the white point toward the center of the image, it's going to really spike the highlights. In fact, we're blowing out our highlights. But if you push it down, you just kind of dull those highlights. You take the snap, the bite, the brightness out of those highlights. I'm going to push our white and our black points back to where they were. Now, if you don't know how to read the histogram, that's totally fine. It really helps if you do. But if you don't, you got the little finger scrubby tool here. We can click on that, and you can simply hover over a part of the image, like down here at the base of the pyramid tower here in San Francisco, and you can click and drag down, let's say, and say, you know what, that tonal portion of the image, I want to make it darker. Or you could drag up and say, you know what, no, I actually want to make it brighter. And then up here in the sky, this brighter area of the image, and by the way, you can see the preview of where it's going to place the point on your curve, right? You can click up there and drag down and say, no, bring that back down, darken that up a bit. Now, the sum net gain of what we just did is just really killing off contrast in our image, but we did make some kind of change. We could do something like say, hey, look, darken up those darks, brighten up the brights, and voila, we're going to have increased contrast very, very quickly. I'm going to once again undo that to reset my curves dialog box. Now, like I mentioned before, you can just bend a little S-curve into your curves dialog box, and no matter what the image is, that's always going to infuse some contrast. If you go with a more extreme S-curve, you're going to get more extreme contrast adjustments. Once again, I will reset this. When you're working with the curves adjustment layer, when you hover over the image, you get this little eyedropper here. So this eyedropper, you can see it's hovering and showing us basically where on our image we would be changing if we click. We do have the scrubby tool selected. But if we do just click once and not move anything, it's going to drop a point right there. And we could come in here manually and move this point up or down, or you can use your arrow keys and move the point around if you're trying to do more fine control or fine adjustments. Curves is also a very, very powerful color adjustment tool. We've got these eyedroppers here. I'm going to ignore the black and the white one. The middle one here is the middle gray sampler. And basically, you can see, as the tooltip would say, sample in image to set a gray point. So we could select this and say, you know what? The side of like this building right here, I know should be gray. And I could say, all right, I'm going to click right on that. And the entire curves adjustment will adjust the entire color of the photo. You can see there's before, there's after. It's going to adjust the color of the image to make sure that the side of that building is a neutral gray and has no color cast. And look at this. You can see here in our curves dialog, we're getting these bizarre colored lines. Well, that's because not only do you have your composite RGB channel, but if I click down, I have my individual red, green, and blue channels as well. Let's explore these a little bit. Once again, I'm going to reset my dialog box by hitting that little flippy-flop arrow down there. And I'm going to explore this. I'm going to come up here to the red channel. I'm going to get rid of my middle gray eyedropper tool for a second. And up here, you add and remove points to your curve, just like you did back in the composite RGB channel. But a couple things. With red, green, and blue, you have six different colors you can play with, essentially, to adjust the color of your image. Red, and the opposite of red is cyan. Green, and the opposite of green is magenta. And blue, and the opposite of blue, which is yellow. So if you know the print colors of cyan, magenta, yellow, you've got cyan, magenta, yellow with your red, green, blue. So CMYK, RGB, it's an easy way to remember the flip side. So red is to cyan, what green is to magenta, what blue is to yellow. So with red, if I pull up, I infuse a lot of red into my image, kind of a cool pinky sunset type look. If I pull down on this curve, it's going to infuse cyan into my image. Maybe not quite what I want there. With green, if I pull up, well, I get a bunch of green. If I pull down, I get a bunch of magenta. A little bit too rich for me, but hey, here in the blue channel, if we pull up, we get a bunch of blue. If we pull down, we get a bunch of yellow. So a lot of stuff you can do here. You can also use your finger scrubby and say, look, we want to remove some of the blue here in this building, but we want to make sure that we come out here and push more blue back into this water or something. I don't know. It's about the same tonal range as that building. Maybe here we push a little bit of blue back into the absolute darkest of shadows, something like that. And we have made this kind of big color shift to our image. I'm just going to reset my curve once more. And one last thing I want to point out about these color channels is they also have the histogram. So we're like, look, we want to boost the reds in the shadows, or maybe we want to boost the cyan in the shadows, but we want to boost the red up in the very brightest parts of the image, and then give red more of a kick in the higher mid-tones of the image. And then maybe we come to the blue channel and we say, look, we're going to raise the blue in the shadows, but we're going to pull down on the blue in the highlights, which is going to infuse yellow into the highlights and give us a bit of this like really pastel lomography type look. Kind of a neat little effect there. I'm going to reset my curves dialog box once more. And the last thing I want to tell you about curves is there are a couple things you want to avoid. Number one, you want to avoid flat spots in your curve. So anytime you have a spot of flat like that in your curve, it symbolizes a total loss of contrast in that tonal range of your image. So this is like most of the mid-tones of our image. And sure enough, you can see in the photo, it reflects that a lot of the shadow detail and information is still there, and some of the brightest parts of the image are still there. Like up in the sky, the very, very bright parts of the sky are still there. But when you get to like the middle, the pixels that are like the middle brightness in the sky, they're all basically solid gray. That's because that's flat. So you want to really work to avoid flat spots. One of the tricks is if you have a flat spot you can't get away, add another point, drag it to the nearest point, and just kind of work the flat spot out. Now, in this case, the curve is all jacked up and messed up, so it's never really going to look good, but at least we use that technique to get rid of a flat spot. I'm going to undo what I did to my curve there. And by the way, if we make our line a total flat line by raising the black point and reducing the white point, and our entire image is a flat line, you can see it just becomes solid 50% gray, a total absence of any contrast. The other thing you want to avoid are downhill runs. So when you have a downhill run, the tonal values within that downhill area get inverted and makes that part of the image look like a negative. So that obviously not the greatest look for pretty much anything. How do you get rid of downhill runs? Well, just adjust those points until you get rid of your downhill run. So just something like that. There we go. Now maybe we're just reducing contrast. Maybe that's the look you're going for. Maybe not. But the point is you don't have that downhill run and you're not just destroying the image. So in this case, I think what we'll do, we'll just boost the shadows. We'll pull down here a little bit to infuse some more darkness in our shadows. We'll boost the highlights a little bit. We'll flatten out the highlights just a touch. And I think what I want to do is go into the blue, and I want to just get rid of some of the blueness in the shadows to give the shadows a little bit more murkiness. And also, there's too much green in the shadows as well. So maybe I'll pull down to add a little bit of magenta down there to the shadows, and then I'm going to combat that by adding some cyan to my highlights. Oh, no, you know what? Maybe I'll add some red to the highlights, something like that. That looks a little bit better. Push a little bit of cyan there into the shadows. And we can just totally change the way the image looks. Give it this kind of flat, murky, heavy, almost like pasty, grungy look very, very quickly with the curves adjustment layer, just by understanding that we can read our curve, use the histogram, and adjust individual color channels as well, all within a single curves adjustment layer. And that's without getting into the fact that you can still mess around with blend modes, adjust the opacity, double click on it and use blend if sliders, all kinds of different really cool stuff you can do with the curves adjustment here in Photoshop. So there you go. I tried to burn through it nice and quickly. Just get a nice crash course on understanding curves in Photoshop. If you enjoyed the video, well, make sure you subscribe to the channel and turn notifications on by hitting that little bell icon so you never miss another video in the future. And if you really enjoy the course, you can pick up my, you can pick up my Photoshop course. It's all about retouching images in Photoshop. I think you'll learn a thing or two, and you help support the channel if you pick up that little course right there. Guys, in this tutorial, we covered a bunch of stuff for messing around with the curves, the white point, the black point, adding contrast, fixing little curve issues like the downhill runs and the flat spots, and things like color channels and the finger scrubby slider tool and the white balance, middle point gray adjustment eyedropper tool, whatever the heck you want to call it, and all the other things we covered in this Photoshop tutorial. Ladies and gentlemen, that's it. Get it? Got it? Good. Nathaniel Dodson, tutvid.com. I'll catch you in the next one. And before you go, make sure you subscribe to my channel for more great tutorials every day. Also, buy my course. It helps us do what we do, and this channel is supported by viewers just like you. You can also just click the thumbnail and watch another video from this channel. See you next time, guys.